Hello and welcome to the How To Carnivore podcast. I'm your host, Simon Lewis, and you're tuning into the Plant-Free MD series with Dr. Anthony Chaffee. Dr. Chaffee is a surgeon, nutritional researcher, and former pro rugby player. He's been strict carnivore for 3 years and an on and off carnivore for more than 20. Dr. Chaffee looks and feels like a real life superhero. If losing fat, building muscle, finding focus, and getting the most out of life is important to you, you're going to love the Plant-Free MD series.
Baby formula is not breast milk. Like, it is just...
Absolutely not.
Even though it's been made for babies, it has nothing to do with breast milk.
Yeah, and the thing is, too, is that, you know, you get these assholes that say, oh, this is perfectly formulated for your baby. There's nothing could be better. It's just like, that's a sales pitch, you know?
Nothing could be better. What about actual breast milk?
Well, that's the really fucked up thing is that, you know, Nestle, they... My parents have been... just refusing to buy any Nestle products since the 70s because they did this whole campaign through Africa and, you know, India and shit like that, saying, oh, you have this formula fed, oh, it's the best thing you could possibly get. It's, you know, so, oh, it's the best thing you could do for your baby. So if you give a shit about your baby, you'll buy this shit. Mm. Well, they're fucking poor, man. And so they couldn't really afford this shit. And so they're already broke. They're getting themselves more broke by doing this, by buying this. And then, so that's fucked. What's more fucked is that because they couldn't afford it, but that's the best thing for their baby, they were just watering it down too much. They're mixing up this as a powder, and they'd water it down.
So the baby's basically getting nothing, just getting water.
So the kids died. There's a lot of kids that starved to death because of this campaign. And by that time, the mom's breast milk had dried up. So there were fucking, I don't even know how many fucking babies died. Mm-hmm. Probably millions. I don't know exactly, but... it was really fucked up.
Yeah, that's pretty fucked up.
And so, yeah, so now that was Nestle saying, oh, you have to do this, whatever. I was just like, fuck off.
And I want to kick off by talking about these kids that Dr. Chaffee showed me, which are full carnivore. And from the photos, they've got massive craniums. And from what you told me, they seem to be developing faster than your average kid.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so, you know, normally we look at kids and they have a range of development. Their milestones usually between this month and that month, and that's what's typically
some sort of like standard normal chart of, like, you know, so you can check if your kid's on track.
Exactly. Yeah, but it's a wide range. Right. Right? So generally you have, like, you know, several months. It's normal in between these sort of big wide ranges. These kids have hit their milestones months earlier than, like, the earliest you would normally see, and like you say, their heads. Quite large. That's because their brains are larger. Brains are developing. We know from the fossil record that cavemen and people before the agricultural revolution, when they were just eating meat, their skulls and their brains were at least 11% larger than they are now for the average adult male.
Wow.
Right. And they were also a slightly different shape. You know, so they were developing in different ways. So now we're seeing this with people that are having kids, you know, having their whole pregnancy as a carnivore and then breastfeeding as carnivore and then feeding their kids carnivore, they just develop very differently. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so for instance, I have a good friend of mine that I was roommates in medical school with.
Cool.
And she has two kids now. When I was first getting into this sort of research, I was, you know, posting a lot of things, talking about all these sorts of things, and then publishing the articles and studies and so forth that was supporting, you know, what I discovered. Hey, look at this. This is really interesting. Mm-hmm. And she was 32 weeks pregnant with her first baby at that point. And she just said, well, look, you know, like he's making a lot of sense. You know, these studies, you know, seem, you know, legit. So, you know, I'll try it out. 32 weeks up until that point, she'd had a pretty rough pregnancy. She'd had hyperemesis, meaning she was projectile vomiting daily, just all day, every day for 32 weeks.
Jesus.
Like, that's just torture. So
yeah,
just
it is.
Months on end. She stopped eating plants. Mm-hmm. The day she stopped eating plants, she just, all vomiting stopped. Mm-hmm. All morning sickness stopped. All everything stopped. And she just had a pretty just normal, nondescript pregnancy after that. Everything was fine. Baby's born. Baby's very healthy. And... you know, before that, she was just eating a standard diet. And at this point, when the baby's born, she's only eating meat and oats because your mom said, you know, you need, you know, oats help bring in your milk, so you should eat a lot of oats. Whatever else you do, eat oats as well. Mm-hmm. And so she was doing that, and great. And she was doing very well, baby's doing very well. And, you know, we were sort of talking, obviously I didn't want to, you know, push anything on her, and I didn't want to, you know, say anything, but I just, you know, was just sort of pointing out that, you know, look, you're doing better than 99.99% of people out there. Yeah. And, you know, it's certainly going to be, you know, helping your daughter. But, you know, carbohydrates, you know, fundamentally derail your biochemistry. They put you into a different metabolic state, so you can't mobilize your energy properly. Also, a grain is a seed, and a seed is a plant's baby, and all organisms protect their babies more than anything. And so in the seeds, nuts, berries, you know, all these sorts of things, that's generally where you'll see the highest concentration of poisons, you know, is why there's cyanide in almonds and so forth. And then peach pits, they have a lot of cyanide. One or two of those can kill you. It takes about a pound to 2 pounds, you know, like 400 to 800 grams of almonds to sort of be a lethal dose, but okay. it still kill you.
Interesting, because there's something inside the peach pit. I don't know if you've ever.
That's what it is. It's called.
It looks like an almond.
It does. Yeah, it's called a bitter almond, and they actually use this in baking.
I wondered about this.
Yeah, yeah. that one or two of those will kill you.
Yeah. Wow. Fantastic.
Yeah, and yeah, exactly. And so they're using baking. They take this for almond flavoring and seasoning, things like that, for like, you know, marzipan, things like that. That's why most sane people hate marzipan.
Because it tastes, you know, aggressively bitter.
Well, yeah, but, you know, this is that taste, you know, is that almondy taste is cyanide. Yeah, that's what cyanide tastes like. And so, yeah, it's people just naturally like, oh,
well, cyanide like dessert, fantastic.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, she, you know, I was saying that, you know, the oats and things like that, you know, these are seeds and grains and so forth. And so this is actually where you find a higher concentration of stuff you don't want. And also, you know, the you know, the carbohydrates and so forth. And, you know, I don't know, because I don't know if anyone's looked into this, but I would imagine that this could possibly go into the breast milk and get into your kid's diet. And so she just said, look, you know, he's been right so far, and like, I trust it, so we'll just give it a try. So all she did at 3 months old, this kid was 3 months old, yep, perfectly well, that very healthy baby. At 3 months old, she just stopped eating oats. That's the only difference. She was already eating meat. She wasn't eating anything else. She only stopped eating oats. And the baby just, her development and growth just hit new levels. And so she just started growing much faster, started developing much more fat, more quickly. Her head got much larger. She was, at 3 months old, she was at 50th percentile for head circumference, length, and weight, okay? 1 month later, at 4 months old, they checked her again. She was 99th percentile for head circumference and length. And then the weight stayed fairly stable. You know, she wasn't like chubby or anything like that. And so just in that 1 month, and she also started trying to walk. She started trying to pull herself up and walk at 4 months old. Okay, so far, far, far ahead. She didn't start walking, but she started trying to do that.
Yeah, wow.
So her head grew so quickly that her pediatric nurse thought that she had hydrocephalus, you know, sort of water in the brain. So it's you have like a blockage in the ventricular system in your brain with the cerebrospinal fluid that flows sort of in and around your brain and your spine.
Okay, so something might be wrong.
Yeah, it starts blowing up like a balloon.
Yeah, wow.
And so it starts pressing on the brain, starts crushing the brain, but also because the bones haven't sealed off yet, they'll just start expanding as well. So you get this globus sort of appearance to the head, and that's very dangerous. I mean, this is a big deal. These kids can die. They can cause severe retardation and developmental delays. It's very, very serious. So she didn't have any of those symptoms. She was actually doing very, very well. And so my friend was, you know, thinking, like, there's no way, you know, that, you know, she has any sort of problems. You know, but she had to go and get it checked out anyway. So we went to, they were going to go to, she went to a pediatric neurosurgeon, to deal with this. So yeah, she was just sort of sitting there in his office and sort of sitting on his leg. And she was telling me, she was just like, you know, I shouldn't have to be here. My kid's fine.
Yeah.
You know, shouldn't have
no
to be
symptoms.
Here. No, yeah, exactly. And she's doing great. And so consultant comes in, he sits there and he has his, you know, his desk there with his picture of his, you know, his wife and his kids and his little dog and everything like that. So I sit down and start making introductions. And the kid's probably, I don't know, 4.5 weeks or 4.5 months old at this time.
Yep.
And she's sitting there on her lap, and the kid just points at the picture on his desk and says, dog, like that, 4.5 months old. And the consultant just looks at her and goes, she's perfect. You don't need to be here. you know, there's no way she has hydrocephalus if she's able to do that.
If she can say like a real, you know, a word.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, dog, 4.5 months. Yeah, and so she's like, she's perfect. You know, she doesn't need to be here. And, you know, and, so, and she just went on like this. And so she's been developing much more quickly. I think she started walking about 8 months old. She's, you know, very, very smart child, very athletic, very, you know, intelligent, and is doing great.
Fascinating.
She, my friend, continued on being carnivore. That kid has eaten nothing in her life except meat. She doesn't want anything else.
How old's the kid now?
Three.
Okay.
Something like that. Yeah, three and a half. And yeah, about that. And you know, sometimes, you know, a relative or something like that will try to go, oh, here's a little cookie, here's a little cake, and she just look at it, throw it away. She doesn't want it. And you know, it wouldn't be good for her anyway. But she's doing great. And she, my friend's never had a problem feeding her. That kid just slapped in the way she's cooking meat. She's just slapping the table and getting all excited. It's like an infant. People looking like, oh, that's, she's getting really excited.
I recently had a customer DM me, like a brand new customer. Yeah. And she said, my daughter ate one of your sausages and started slapping the table.
Yeah.
And she's doing, and she's just slapping the table and like calling out and saying more.
Yeah. I remember seeing someone. So this is the first time I've given my dog steak, and it's like giving the dog just goes. It's like mouth, it's like jaws is just like vibrating. Oh God, please! And it's just like, oh God, no more. And it's just like everything, his body is like, this is what you were meant to eat. This is life itself.
Yeah.
And you just get
nutrients.
And so it's great. So my friend stayed full carnivore the whole time. She then got pregnant with her second child, a young boy. And she was carnivore the entire time, and they kept having to move up her expected due dates because the kid was developing so fast. It was actually developing faster as a fetus. It wasn't actually developing faster per se. It was developing normally.
Yeah.
It's just that everyone else is actually
lagging behind.
You know, exactly, because they're doing things that aren't giving proper nutrition, enough nutrition, and then putting in, you know, different things in their body that actually are going to slow growth and development and so forth. And so that's what we think is normal. It's not normal. How these kids are developing is normal. And this kid came out very healthy, early, you know, his due date was early because it was developing so much quicker. It's ready. And his head circumference is in the 105th percentile. I didn't even know that was a thing. It was just like 99th, and that's it. That's, you know, now it's just like, no, it's literally off the charts. It's so much further.
We don't even take that into account when we're doing our
So it's just like, well, this is 99% percentile, meaning that your head circumference is bigger than 99%. I mean, that means you're the 100%. But it's like, no, it's even bigger than that.
Yeah.
It's a lot bigger than that. So, you know, that would then, basically what it would do is that's the 99th percentile. And then whoever was in the 99th percentile four is now 96 or something like that. It's more of a realistic way of doing that.
Yeah.
But sort of just, you know, broke the curve.
Broke the chart.
You know? And so, people are taking the test and they blow the curve and just get this massive test and, you know, screws everyone else. So that's what these kids have done. And they've just been doing great. And, you know, this kid is growing so much quicker. Mm-hmm. And he's just a tank.
Mm-hmm.
And he's growing out, you know, he's like 3 months old wearing, you know, like year old clothes and things like that. And, you know, and so they're just developing so much better than you'd see. And unfortunately you see, you know, the opposite in people that don't do that.
You know? Totally. I mean, I'm not a parent, so I can't quite understand sort of a parent's psychology, but I just imagine that, okay, so every parent probably wants their kid instinctively to do sort of better than the average.
Yeah. Or just as well as they can, as best that they can.
Exactly. Yeah. But if there's the motivator of, hey, morning sickness goes, you can produce enough, the right amount of breast milk, and your kid's going to be happier and kind of not cracking the shits and crying all the time and actually be sustained. I mean, even from like a selfish perspective as a parent, it's like, hey, this is an easier path.
Well, it is. I guess, you know, who considers what easy? I mean, some people don't really consider, you know, eliminating out, you know, all these sorts of plant foods easy. I do. I don't think that's a problem at all.
Yeah, yeah. I feel the same. It's like, you know, it's a change that's going to make you healthier and your baby and all those extra things that could cause complications in your life. It's more about getting to the source, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just getting on the first principles. This is the best nutrition for these kids. But the other thing is, too, is that, you know, a lot of people are saying it's not. A lot of people are saying, you know, you're going to hurt yourself, you're going to hurt your kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're going to give them heart disease as an infant if you give them anything with saturated fats. It's like, okay. Mm-hmm. Even if that were true, it'd be worth it because their brain won't develop otherwise.
Without saturated fat.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And DHA and so forth. You know, that's you know, your brain is made 70% lipids, fats. Okay. 20% of those fats are DHA. Those don't exist in plants.
Mm.
We don't make them.
Mm.
Not well, anyway.
Yeah.
You have to get them from a source. This is why they call fish brain food, right? Because they had a lot of DHA.
Okay.
And the reason that that was called brain food as opposed to steak, which also has a lot of DHA, is because fish had unsaturated fats. And obviously, only the unsaturated fats are the good fats.
Right, okay.
And so that's why they said eat fish. You know, because that's brain food, and that's a safe fat to eat.
Yeah,
that's a good fat.
And we can maintain this idea that we've spread about saturated fat being bad, so we'll say just stick to fish.
Yeah, exactly, which is wrong.